Good evening, everyone. We welcome you all to Ortho TV Online Original Webinar Series. And today we have with us my very good friend and a very eminent shoulder and elbow surgeon all the way from Nagpur, Dr. Ashay Kekarpurik. He's a consultant in shoulder, elbow and knee surgery, associate professor and unit head of NKP Salve Medical College in Nagpur. And he's also the director of his own Apex Ortho Euro Clinic. He has done his fellowship in shoulder and elbow surgery from Asan Medical Center, Seoul, North Korea. And he was an ex-research professor in the Department of Orthopedics, Ulsan University in Seoul, South Korea. I think I said North Korea. It's Asan Medical Center is in Seoul, South Korea. So I hand over to Dr. Ashay Kekarpurik, who's going to speak on rotator cuff tear diagnosis and repair options, arthroscopic and open. Over to you, Ashay.
Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks a lot, Neeraj, sir. It is always a great pleasure to be of any service to Ortho TV and medical faculty as well as orthopedic surgeons. So today we will be talking about day-to-day OPD basis rotator cuff tear diagnosis and repair option. What you tell your patients. So I'm going to put forward some of my humble thoughts, which I have accumulated and gathered across with the years of experiences, with the years of experience I had in shoulder elbow surgery. So rotator cuff tear, we can forget about throwing activities for a few years. This is a image which is very self-descriptive of what happens with a rotator cuff tear in a day-to-day person. The most important clinical dilemma which happens for anyone who come across a patient with shoulder pain is we ask ourselves whether it is a tear or is it adhesive capsulitis or is it a neck pain with radiation to shoulder and below or is it a combination of all. So to deal with this question, we should always remember that pain around the shoulder can be a very layered phenomenon. There could be a cuff tear, acute cuff tear, a traumatic one, a chronic, acute on chronic tear with combination of adhesive capsulitis, with combination of neck pain which has been radiating to the shoulder and below. The difference will be people who are complaining of exclusively shoulder pain, which will come with like this, if they don't have any neck element. But if they have an involved neck element, the main complaint, the way they will hold their shoulder into is this and this. Okay? So we have to delineate the causes of the cuff tear, the shoulder pain, depending on the site of origin of that pain. So in due course of presentation, we'll slowly try to delineate all. So necessary part is of your clinical examination is a neck examination, which is mandatory whenever you are evaluating the shoulder for cuff tear. So if it is a cuff tear, we need to ask ourselves, is it a single tendon tear or multiple tendons have involved? What physical examination will give you best predictive value of diagnosis? What imaging modality will be most helpful for you? So as Sun Tzu, 2000 years back, he said that we need to understand our enemy. If we consider a surgery is a battleground, then we need to understand what exactly we are dealing with and answer to this situation on merit. As this is important because the reported re-tear after a rotator cuff injury is 37.3%, which is quite significant. So we need to be very specific, very meticulous whenever we are planning our diagnosis and treatment options of cuff tear. So I'm going to divide my presentation into these five heads. What is my philosophy? How do we diagnose it? What are the patient factors, typical surgical options, and post-operative rehab? So this will give us a comprehensive bird's eye view of cuff repair. So dealing with philosophy. So rotator cuff tear is akin to an uprooted tree. As we all know, apart from the heart, supraspinatus tendon is the only muscle in his heart, only muscle in our body, which is at continuous stretch, even at rest. So the only position the supraspinatus can be slightly or completely relaxed is in slight 30 degrees of abduction. So this is like, the cuff tear is like an uprooted tree. We need to carefully plant it whenever we are doing a rotator cuff repair and to see forward to it that the uprooted tree takes good roots into the soil, which is the bone which we are implanting into. So this is the philosophy which I would like to share with you. So what are the key factors in predictable outcome of rotator cuff repair? First and foremost is patient selection, the structural integrity of our repair, and post-operative rehab. A combination of all these three factors which will give you a predictable, reproducible rotator cuff repair and a very happy patient, which all of us want. So again, going to this slide. So what are the various physical examination that will give you a best predictive value or best predictive diagnosis of cuff tear? So clinical tests and signs: empty can, lateral rotation lag test, full can test, and belly press test. These will give you a delineated idea of which particular tendon is involved in cuff tear. And lift off test, as well as the knees test. So empty can test will give you, the empty can test basically brings the infraspinatus below the acromion and test it against force. So it gives you an idea of whether the infraspinatus is torn or inflamed. The external rotation lag is a telltale sign of rotator cuff tear. The arm draw test for full thickness supraspinatus and full thickness infraspinatus tear. The Hawkins tendinity test gives you a predictive value for full thickness supraspinatus tears. The Neal test is diagnostic of a full thickness supraspinatus tear. So a patient coming with subjective night pain, the location of pain is consistent with the shoulder lateral aspect. He has a history of trauma, weakness, or progressive loss of function. With positive empty can, Hawkins Kennedy, and painful arc test, then you can be certain that it is a full thickness rotator cuff tear. With all these prerequisites, you can go ahead with whatever is the most useful imaging modality, which is X-ray, USG, MRI. What is the progression of this torn rotator cuff? Why we need to understand it? Basically, if there is a cuff tear, the counterbalance, the main action of the supraspinatus is to initiate abduction. So it is acting as a depressor in the first 0 to 15 degrees of abduction. So it is stabilizing the humeral head against the glenoid. So which cannot be counterbalanced by the upward pull of the deltoid on the humerus. So it is as the supraspinatus is not there, the head of the humerus is not being secured against the glenoid. So we see slight proximal migration of the humeral head. Just a second. So this leads to abutment of the humeral head against the acromion, and there is a progressive acetabulization, that is a concave deformity of the undersurface of the acromion, as you can see in this particular X-ray. And in the last stage, there happens arthropathy. These all changes can be nicely seen on an X-ray. So X-ray has got a definitive predictive value in diagnosing the cuff tear. So this is the Hamada and Fukuda stages of cuff arthropathy, where the various stages of cuff arthropathy are nicely delineated. So how will you see, or how will you diagnose a cuff tear with an X-ray finding? So Dr. Gerber has nicely described the critical shoulder angle, in which we draw a perpendicular line from the inferior aspect, connecting the superior and the inferior aspect of the glenoid, and drop it perpendicular. The second side is from the same point up to the lateral edge of the acromion. So in that case, if the angle is less than 30 degrees, it is associated with arthritis. If it is more than 35 degrees, it is associated with degenerative rotator cuff tear. Also, we need to note the proximal migration of the humerus, which is also another telltale sign of rotator cuff tear. Another useful finding is the acromial index. If it is more than 0.7, it is associated with degenerative rotator cuff tear. As I mentioned to you, the proximal humeral migration symptomatic and asymptomatic rotator cuff tear. Loss of rotator cuff integrity in both symptomatic and asymptomatic is definitively associated with proximal head migration. As this paper have nicely examined the glenohumeral kinematics, and they change with asymptomatic versus symptomatic cuff tear. With asymptomatic, there is a less superior migration, and in massive cuff tears, both in symptomatic and asymptomatic, there is a superior migration of the humeral head. So the critical size of the superior migration is 1.5 centimeters of tear will definitely result into superior migration of the humeral head. On MRI, you will be able to note fluid collection in the torn ridge from the greater tuberosity up to the torn edge of the tendon. Okay, so the picture on the left depicts a normal tear where the continuity of the muscle fibers is nice and complete till the greater tuberosity, whereas on the picture on the right side, it shows the muscle continuity is disrupted and you are able to see the fluid collection and signal changes, diagnosis of rotator cuff tear. Now we need to understand how much is the retraction of that tendon from the greater tuberosity. So these are the various grades, up to 1 centimeters, 1 to 2 centimeters, and more than 2 centimeters up to the glenoid ridge. So this will determine whether you will be able to bring the tendon back without any tendon, without any tension, up to the greater tuberosity. Repairing the tendon without tension is mandatory and integral part in having a stable repair. Another most important thing which you will get, or information as per, you will get from MRI, is the amount of fatty infiltration of rotator cuff. So this has been nicely classified by Gotalier into 4 grades. So in normal grade, there is no fatty infiltration. Okay, so the entire amount is covered with muscle. There is no signs of fat. In grade 1, there are streaks of fat, but still the component of muscle is intact. In grade 2, there is more muscle than fat. In grade 3, the muscle and fat are equal. It's also called as a Y sign. If you draw a line connecting the acromion and the coracoid, you will see that the muscle aspect is lower than this line. And if it is completely disrupted, if it is more fat than muscle, then it is grade 4. Now, why it is essential to ask your radiologist to mention about the Gotalier grading is because if you repair a grade 2 or grade 3 and grade 4 fatty infiltration, then the chances of failure of your tendon is almost 92%. Okay, if the tendon has retracted. So we need to be very careful whenever we are repairing a grade 3, grade 4 Gotalier staged cuff. Now, on MRI, the fatty infiltration looks like this. And they have talked about the relationship of the tear size, understanding why it is essential, and imperative for the treating surgeon to understand the amount of fat infiltration is, because as fat infiltrates the muscles, once the pination angle, which is important for the muscle to act, it changes. So what is a pination angle? Along the longitudinal axis, the muscle fibers, they form an acute angle, which is necessary for contraction and relaxation. When a microscopic finding was taken by Gerber, they found that with the fatty infiltration, the pination angle increases, the angle becomes more obtuse, and therefore the muscle is not able to act. So even after you repair a muscle, which has been Gotalier grade 3 or 4, by getting it up to the greater tuberosity, and if it is infiltrated with fat, it will not be able to act. The power produced will not be low, and ultimately the patient satisfaction will be low in those cases. So If we consider patients, many patients, they have certain order. If we know patients who are 55 years and above, they have a partial or a complete cuff tear, which is asymptomatic. And how does the symptomatic transition from asymptomatic rotator cuff tear happens? Usually, over a period of 2 years, 21% of the patient with an asymptomatic rotator cuff tear, they will become symptomatic. And the symptomatic transition of asymptomatic tear is associated with significant increase in pain and loss of function. Usually, there is an instigating cause, such as lifting of a bag from a conveyor belt in the airport, or trying to get something, or fetching something, or trying to climb the local trains in Mumbai. So there is a certain event where the asymptomatic transits to a symptomatic. And tear size usually progresses in these transitions. And they may play a significant role during these transitions. So in all these cases, early detection is the key. We need to make more our patients more aware about rotator cuff tear. And we need to make them aware that if they fail to understand the severity of this issue, that can lead to difficult surgery later on. So coming to the patient factor, smoking increases the risk of cuff tears. Okay, there is enough evidence now that there is a strong association and a very high statistical significance that there is a time-dependent relationship between number of packs you smoke and the cause of cuff repair. Moreover, if you are a smoker, then the quality of repair is low, the quality of your tendon is bad, and the formation of shapling fibers and the resulting cuff repair is low. So we should definitely guard, or rather prevent our patients from smoking after we have repaired it. I've mentioned as a disclaimer, if they are smokers and they are undergoing this rotator cuff repair. Diabetes definitely impairs the tendon bone healing after rotator cuff repair. NSAIDs, there is a misrelationship. We need to give, or rather prescribe, NSAIDs in a very conservative patients in whom we are repairing a cuff tear. Traditionally, in this particular paper, they have spoken about significantly in the traditional cyclooxygenases 2 inhibitors have inflamed, or rather non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents have significantly inhibited the tendon to bone healing in animal models. Obesity has a negative impact on operative time of arthroscopic cuff repair, length of hospitalization, and functional outcomes. So we should be wary of these patients. So what are the operative indications? And what are the non-operative treatment options? And the most important aspect which we need to understand is all shoulders are not used equally. There are certain patients who are using their shoulders more as compared to other patients. So in these patients, the aspects or the things to be considered are different when you are operating a normal patient. So what about special situation? What about rotator cuff repair in patients who are rheumatoid, very elderly? In all those patients, we need to titrate our surgical options depending on the various patient characteristics that we have discussed, and give them a tailor-made plan for repair. It is not like one cut fits all. Okay, you have to understand what is the patient criteria, what is the best that will work in your hands, and what is the best chance that the patient will have a good repair that will stay, and there will be no chances. You have to decrease the chances of re-tear in those patients. So what are the problems with chronic changes? There is a retraction with adhesion, the tendon morphology changes, the muscle atrophies, there is fatty degeneration, and degenerative changes of the cuff. And sooner or later, it undergoes cuff arthropathy. We need to discuss with our patients whenever we are talking about non-operative treatment options. We need to make them understand that what will happen to the tear size if they undergo a non-operative treatment option, and the risk of development of these asymptomatic patients to symptomatic patients, and further progression of those symptoms, those symptomatic cuff tear to increasing size of the tear, and progression of those cuff two irreversible shoulder arthropathies is that needs to be titrated depending on the patient profile. And the patient needs to understand what is the risk that will dictate the urgency of that particular surgery. So in what patients do we ask them to undergo early operative that can halt a chronic change? Most pertinently in traumatic young patients who have got a traumatic cuff tear, acute, small or medium sized tear, the adage that a stitch in time saves nine fits particularly well in this particular pathology. A proper stitch taken at a proper time definitely will save the pain of repairing a large cuff. And it's important for the tears at risk of fatty degeneration and altered kinematics of the shoulder. I'm sure through the various webinars across, we have came across many ways, and there are many ways to pell the cat. It is, there is an open repair, mini open repair, and arthroscopic repair. Of course, with the advances now, mini open repair is the gold standard. And the results of arthroscopic repair are as good as a mini open repair. There are various ways you can do a transosseous repair. You can do a single row, you can go ahead and do a suture bridge. So it depends on your particular skill level and what is the armamentarium at your disposal. That will dictate your surgical intervention. We all know that transosseous repair has got the best, it is considered as a gold standard, and it has got a better surface area and coverage of the glenoid tuberosity. Okay, it has got a better healing. The only issue is we have to deal with the tuberosity fractures and the muscle tendon junction ruptures. In a very nice and descriptive paper described by Professor In Ho Jeon from Busan, South Korea, they have studied the effects of cuff repair and how it has healed on a histopathological detailed study. So they have understood the formation of those Shapney fibers in progressive years in mice. And what they have came across is that repair should be tension free, okay? And the footprint should be covered as much as possible. Also, whenever you are going ahead with the crimson duvet, the size of those microfractures should be small. So this is an example. This is an example of a 71-year-old lady with a massive cuff tear. So she is not able to do forward elevation and abduction. So I will present to you a runway video. So certain important steps that needs to be considered whenever we are doing the cuff repair in a shoulder. First is the standard glenohumeral arthroscopy. We have to see the biceps fully, whether how the biceps is, okay? If it is inflamed, if the biceps is inflamed, we have to answer with the biceps sternotomy and tenodesis. Now with further development, now we can do a standard or a modified SCR using the biceps from the, we can just do a biceps sternotomy at the lateral edge and use that part of the biceps as a graph for our superior capsular reconstruction and repair the rest of the remaining cuff to that biceps. So this is a standard glenohumeral posterior portal. My rod is coming from the anterior portal. Okay, you visualize to try to do maximum of your work regarding debridement of the cuff, of the torn cuff, from the glenohumeral posterior portal. So that will save you some amount of time. Okay, so you mark, then you can go to the subacromial portion, the subacromial part. If you are starting your surgery, just starting the cuff repair, you can just do a nice acromioplasty. First, we need to take care of the bursa, the lateral bursa. Now, there is good reports which are coming up, which has said to preserve as much as possible the medial bursa, because that is the bursa which has got a good healing potential. Okay, with due course now, this is the old case. The due course now, I've started using the cotri, the vapor slightly less and using the shaver as far as possible. I don't use a pump. So it is all gravity assisted irrigation. Along with that, all my positions I do in lateral position. Okay. So that also saves a lot of time. I usually do a marking stretch. Okay. Marking this stretches through the biceps. And so you see, I've just done a soft tissue acromioplasty. I clear and prepare the lateral surface of the greater tuberosity. Okay. So you have to have a nice bleeding surface over there of the tuberosity. You can see the cuff. This is the posterior lateral portal. We are able to see the delamination aspect of the cuff. You need to prepare nicely the bed to receive the tendon and to create a nice surface so that the cuff can heal properly. Okay. So we should think ourselves basically as gardeners or farmers, where we are preparing everything so as to we can re-implant the cuff nicely and ensure maximum chances for complete recovery. So here I'm preparing the greater tuberosity with my shaver. You can use a burr. Most of the times what I have found is that in our presentation is that the females, the bone is porotic. If you use the burr excessively, then there is a chances that you can cause a lot of depression over here. And try to control bleeding as far as possible. Okay, so try to have as far as possible a good clarity of your field. Try to control the bleeding wherever there are small bleeders. Okay, now the first anchor, which comes, there is a good bone stock is just next to the biceps. Okay, that bicipital tuberosity. Bicipital groove. So it's got the maximum good amount of bone where your anchor can safely land. Okay, we'll have a good purchase over there. Of course, the anchor goes into nice Denman angle. Okay, it is usually I usually use a double loaded anchor on the so this cuff particularly was a double row fixation. So there was an anchor anteriorly near the biceps, and then another anchor lateral. Any time of suturing device can be used. You can use an anti-grade suture passer, the one which we have used over here, like a Scorpio. If you are okay or very good with the normal suture passer also, that can be used. Now I am going slowly towards usage of ATOS, arthroscopic transverseous reconstruction, without any anchors or without any suture passing devices. So that has decreased my need for different kind of armamental devices. Okay, so once you pass all the sutures should be nicely spaced out. They are marked definitely, and they are brought out by the window, by the anterior portals. Okay, then you see how the cuff sits. Okay, you just retrieve them on those specifically and try to understand how your configuration sits nicely on the greater tuberosity. Okay, so in this particular case, after making the cuff set, there was a need for a lateral anchor, a lateral row. Okay, and so this is the lateral row. So all four stitches, they were brought almost like 2 to 2.5 centimeters laterally. Okay, and we used a swivel lock anchor, and there is a progressive tightening of those tendons, those sutures at the lateral aspect. So there is a first and foremost, you try to fix the position where you are going to put your lateral anchor. So here are certain technical tips. You need to be using your high posterior lateral portal. You need to create enough soft tissue clearance so that the bursa doesn't keep coming in your way. The visualization needs to be absolutely clear. And you need to have a good assistant to understand what exactly you are doing. Okay. and then you pass all those sutures and just see. Okay, so there is a progressive tightening. Now you see the cuff comes and sits nicely over here. So this is the final repair. Here later on you can add crimson duvet, the thing which I was talking about, and you need to keep the size of your microfracture because it has been shown in various studies that the size of the microfractures, small microfractures, really has got a good healing effect rather than making big punctured holes. So that is crimson duvet for you. So this is the final repair. Yeah. So this patient, she had a good recovery. She had good recovery, and this is the follow-up video by the patient. Yeah. Now, how to deal with certain patients in whom the cuff repair is such that there is a huge amount of retraction. What will you do in these cases? A very nice technique of superior capsular reconstruction, in which, so I do my superior capsular reconstruction using the tensor facial latter. So here you can see the biceps and the subscapular, there is a mild degeneration without any tear. The supraspinatus and the infraspinatus, there is a complete tear. So here you need to prepare your greater tuberosity and footprint, and you need to decorticate the infraspinatus aspect of the footprint. Then tensor fascia lata graft is prepared. Okay, so you need to double your graft. What you can do is that you can put a mesh which is used in hernia surgeries in between the fascia lata to increase the thickness. Okay, and then you can put this graft. So superior capsular reconstruction can be easily done in open way. If you are proficient enough with arthroscopic repair, you can do arthroscopic repair. So this is the superior capsular reconstruction done open. Now I am slowly progressing towards arthroscopic superior capsular reconstruction. So the most important aspect of post-operative rehab is that we have to prevent stiffness. We have entered the cuff, healing of the cuff is a slow process. Okay, it takes time. I usually tell all my patients that it is going to take almost like 8 to 10 weeks before we are allowing them to do anything substantial with their arm. Okay. Usually what we start them with is that passive abduction and forward elevation slowly. I ask my physiotherapist to go very, very slow, extremely slow, because an abrupt jerk by a physiotherapist or an untrained person can definitely take or toss your repair. Okay, we need to be very careful. There is enough amount of literature which is now talking about cuff healing and what formation is there. So basically, initially the tendon heals by scar formation. So there is a progressive scar formation which generalizes normally, okay, and then there is a formation of those sharpening fibers, okay, and to hasten this biological healing aspect, as we spoke about, you can create micropunctate bleeding. So instead of creating those big holes, as I mentioned before, we need to decrease the size of those crimson duvet holes which we make, okay, by taking 1.6 mm or 2 mm K wires instead of using those introducers. making holes in that. You almost take 12 weeks for the Shapney fibers for the tendon bone reattachment. And it is always, always, always at these interfaces that the repair needs to happen. Most of the times, if you put your repair or your cuff repair too firmly, because the material which we are using is a fiber wire, which has got an inbuilt microfilament of metal. So it is going to be stronger than the tendon. And in due course of time, it is going to cause some amount of lysis in the tendon. So if it is too firm a repair, that also is counterproductive. So the re-tear which happens, it's at the muscle-muscle junction, which becomes very difficult to address. So coming to the rehabilitation aspect after a small to medium repair, size repair and rotator cuff. Pain management, it depends on you. Usually IRs manage them on acetaminophen, ECM drips, and intraoperatively, I started injecting them with bupivacaine, and I myself give a small block on the posterior aspect. A 30 degree abduction brace, as we have discussed at the start, is mandatory to make the tendon heal nicely without any kind of a tension. Okay, and there is enough amount of study of the role of brace on abduction and rotation, which needs to be there for keeping the tension repair under without the duress. So how long your patient should wear the brace, there are no perfect guidelines. Usually in a small tear for 4 weeks, in large tear up to 6 weeks, and also depending on the various other patient factors such as obesity, diabetes, everything, and how good repair you have done. So the surgeon is the best person to what kind of a brace period he should ascribe. I usually ask my patients to wear the brace for 8 weeks, and then I slowly wean them off. Meanwhile, whenever they are in brace, I ask them to move their elbows, okay, so as to prevent any kind of a stiffness. Shoulder range of movement, no. We need to discuss with the patient and make them understand what exactly they want and what exactly what we have done. And we really, really need to tell them about the quality of the tendon repair. In 1 to 2 weeks, we allow them elbow range of movement, okay? And then if you have done a bicep stenosis, we should not ask them to pronate or supinate if you have done a tenodosis, because that will affect the repair, the healing. In 3 to 4 weeks, they can do some abduction exercises, pendulum exercises, okay, forward bending, arm swinging, okay. Usually it takes around, as I told you, 5 to 6 weeks to 8 weeks, they can wean off the braces, and at 3 months or so, they can start sending exercises and they are back to driving cars. And at 12 weeks onwards, you can start strengthening exercises, the TheraBand and activation, active elevation. The arm can be lifted forward under its own power. It can be used straight, which increases the lever arm. So this is all about cuff repair. And I had the pleasure of meeting and working with some of the few dignitaries across the world in shoulder and elbow surgery. And this is Professor In Ho John from South Korea. He has been my mentor. Thank you. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Ashay. That was an excellent presentation and a very good video technique. So we'll just stop your screen share for now. Yeah. I have a few questions which we get from the audience. To begin with, the question number one is that when you showed that retracted tear and superior capsular reconstruction. So is it possible to decide only on the basis of MRI and the patient profile that you are going to do SCR and not try to repair it?
Yes. I mean, if it is a gluteal grade 3 and grade 4 degeneration, you can decide right then and there only that whether you are going ahead with the surgery. The basis remains the same. It is not only the quality of your repair, but also the quality of the tendon. Okay. So if you are repairing a worn out tendon, then what mostly you are going to happen, what mostly you are going to have is a re-tear. Okay. This will become slightly difficult to address because already you have violated the regenerative process. So it is better to go ahead with the SCR in the first row in a grade 3, grade 4 degeneration.
Okay. the next question is a little simpler. The pasta lesions, which are now reported very easily on 3 Tesla MRIs. Everybody is now reporting pasta lesions. Earlier, we were not able to see them on a low quality MRI, but on higher quality MRIs, it is very easy. So what is your treatment protocol for that?
Partial tears are more painful. So it is what the patient symptomatology should dictate regarding the repair. So I will not be very much worried if it is a sedentary worker, okay? He is non-dominant arm. To address it, or rather, I will rather give him a first single dose of steroid after, of course, due consultation and due consent and everything, that there is a chance of a definitive progression towards a more symptomatic or a bigger repair. But let us go ahead and try this, or rather do this, okay? What I have found is that almost 80% of these patients who are not very high demanding, they do well with subacromial steroid injections for a pasta lesion. Okay, if there is a bursitis involved. If it is a high demand patient who is an athlete, then we need to really address and go ahead. So definitely, as we have dictated, those five elements, if it is a quotient profile, which will determine the kind of search option, or rather the treatment option to forward.
And in a rotator cuff tear arthropathy or rotator cuff tear, when would you advise a reverse shoulder and not a SCR?
So as you have told, there is a complete acetabularization, and the humeral head shown chances of degeneration. Then you are left with no options per se. Then you have to go ahead with the reverse shoulder.
And whenever you are
operating, if it is arthropathy, it is a telltale arthropathy. Then yes.
Okay. So in a Gutiliar 4, you will still would like to go.
Sorry, I didn't get your question.
Sorry. In a Gutiliar 4, would you like to still go for the SCR and not the reverse shoulder, if there is no degeneration of the bones?
Yes, I will first offer them, because the SCR I still feel is a more conservative. I am slightly more conservative, so it is a I would like to have the patient's original shoulder rather than giving them a joint, because the revision rate after the SCR we have still the option left of a shoulder, but there is nothing left after the reverse.
Right. And what about the rehab protocol? Do you have a fixed rehab protocol for all patients? That your patient video which you showed of the rehab, that patient was quite dedicated patient who's doing a lot of rehab and sending you videos also from her home. We rarely get these type of dedicated patients who are ready to do a good rehab.
Yes, exactly.
Because post rotator cuff tear, rehab is initial days is quite painful for many patients. So how do you counsel them?
You really, I okay, that is a very good question, sir. That is very good question. I usually, first and foremost, make them understand what exactly we are doing. I mean, patient participation is, I think, a key element in having a good, stable repair. Okay, so they need to understand that their participation in the rehab protocol is going to determine what kind of output or what kind of a result they are going to get. So this brings some awareness and some onus on them to participate in the process. And as I told you, I go very slow. I don't allow them any kind of a aggressive active elevation till around 6 to 8 weeks. If I feel that the patient is slightly non-compliant to the rehab, I come to the physiotherapy unit and get it supervised, okay? So they slowly start seeing the change, and mostly what I have understood is that if the patient is doing rehab with other patients, they are more compliant and it's more easy to convince them to undergo this rehabilitation exercise.
Yes, right. So thank you. Thank you, Ashay. Thanks. Thank you for having such a wonderful presentation with such a great video. It will be a review video for many young shoulder surgeons or upcoming arthroscopy surgeons who want to come and review how to do a rotator cuff repair. And it is a comprehensive coverage which you have given all our audience. And we thank Dr. Ashay Kekatpure to take out time for Ortho TV. And we also thank our audience who have been coming to us every week, week after week, for this Ortho TV original series. Thank you, everyone, and good night.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. Thank you for having me.